in this converted parking lot in Silicon Valley. Yuval Bahar is demonstrating a pressure release of hydrogen at his startup, ECL.
The hydrogen is very, very cold. It comes out of the vents and actually freezing the water molecules in the air.
Hydrogen is one of the bold alternative power sources seeing big investment as AI workloads sent energy demand soaring. A chemical reaction between hydrogen and oxygen inside this fuel cell creates extreme heat and water vapor that's converted to power, then stored in large batteries like this Tesla Megapack, so it can power a small on-site data center filled with 1,600 NVIDIA GPUs.
This is the first data center which is running off-grid on hydrogen.
Data centers could reach a whopping 12% of total U.S. power consumption by 2028, up from less than 4% in 2022 before ChatGPT hit the scene. Microsoft and Google's renewable energy goals were upended by this sudden need to power AI. Natural gas is fueling the majority of this, for now.
We are trying to actually ban natural gas just a few months ago, and now it's actually the hottest material out there to actually generate energy. We're starting to restart coal again, which is outrageous that it's happening.
Then in January, China unveiled DeepSeek, with efficiency breakthroughs that cast doubt on power needs. And the new administration also cast doubt on funding for green energy.
I don't think DeepSeek is going to make any difference to the investments in data centers. Moving from sort of Biden's approach, where there was lots of support for renewable energy investment, to whatever Trump is going to do with that, that's going to make a bigger difference.
China, meanwhile, is all in on new energy solutions like nuclear fusion, recently breaking records and outpacing the U.S. in government spend to make it happen.
I do think that this is a worldwide competition.
So big tech is throwing big money at making new kinds of power domestically. OpenAI CEO Sam Altman has invested hundreds of millions in fusion and fission, plus a new type of solar. Amazon's put $500 million into three small nuclear reactor projects. Microsoft has green hydrogen and nuclear fusion deals. Google is helping run some of its data centers on geothermal.
What does power demand from AI mean for the power sector, and how do we make it clean, reliable, and cheap? I think it's the story of the decade.
CNBC went behind the scenes at two companies creating energy in unusual ways and talked to the heads of four more to see how they work and ask if an AI power crisis could finally help realize the elusive dream of low-carbon, scalable, affordable energy. After OpenAI's ChatGPT release in November 2022 made large language models a must-have across industries, cloud providers have been racing to build data centers that can handle them. Microsoft, Meta, Google, and Amazon spent a combined $125 billion on data centers in 2024. And those data centers need more and more power to train and run AI models. The AI frenzy has data center power demand rising 15 to 20% every year through 2030 in the U.S.
An average data center, which is about 100 megawatts, consumes as much energy as 100,000 U.S. households.
Then last month, DeepSeek flipped the script. Its more efficient models made some ask, will the AI-fueled surge in power demand continue?
Everyone will look at what they've done and copy that, so we'll see everybody suddenly getting an order of magnitude or two more efficient. I think it's just going to create more demand sooner.
Ideally, what comes from some of this is a renewed focus of saying, hey, like, we need to lead this in the U.S.
It's unclear if energy startups will also continue to receive Biden-era federal grants and tax breaks.
How does a Trump administration change this story around alternate energy investments?
I think the Trump administration has pretty clearly said that they want to invest in oil and gas.
We will drill, baby, drill.
I would be worried if I was trying to build and fund a first of a kind of something completely new right now.
The new Environmental Protection Agency head has called for clean power as the U.S. strives to become the AI capital of the world. And a few days before China's DeepSeek release, President Trump announced Stargate, a joint venture to fund domestic AI infrastructure, including data centers, with up to $500 billion over the next 4 years, with investments from SoftBank, OpenAI, and Oracle.
If that goes through, will we need all these alternate energy projects to fund that much AI?
Potentially, but I mean, they could do it with gas power. The simple, easiest thing you can build is lots of big gas-powered plants.
Indeed, as major cloud providers build power-hungry data centers, their pledges to become carbon-free are getting harder to achieve. Google's latest environmental report says greenhouse gas emissions rose nearly 50% from 2019 to 2023, in part because of data center energy consumption. Microsoft's emissions rose more than 29% due to data centers designed and optimized to support AI workloads. Power needs are so high that some plans to close coal-fired power plants are being put on hold, like in Kansas City, where Meta is building an AI-focused data center.
It interrupts the transition to renewable power. We had enough renewables coming online for where we thought we were going, and all of a sudden they've got, oh, there's this new additional demand.
We're going to need everything that we can get, especially those technologies that are always on, that are providing electricity continuously 24 hours a day.
The most readily available renewables, wind and solar, don't typically fit this bill. That's why Bahar founded ECL in Mountain View, California, where he gave us a tour.
We had a goal to actually deliver a fully sustainable data center that will have zero emission coming out of it and zero water use.
Hydrogen is not usually emissions-free, but it is able to power ECL's small 1-megawatt AI data center entirely off-grid and cooled only by the water created on-site. Water is a byproduct of hydrogen power generation.
And then we feed that water back into our cooling system to be able to deliver water-based cooling.
Every couple weeks, this tank is filled with 16,000 gallons of hydrogen trucked in from Southern California or Nevada. There are three main types of hydrogen, known by different color codes depending on how they're made. Gray hydrogen accounts for some 95% of the world's current consumption and is made using fossil fuels, releasing a significant amount of CO2 when it's produced. Blue hydrogen uses the same process, but with carbon capture to reduce the impact. That's primarily what ECL receives. Green hydrogen is produced from renewable energy through a significantly more expensive process using wind or solar to split water molecules apart.
The completely green hydrogen is a tiny fraction of the hydrogen that's available, and it's more expensive.
The Biden administration in January finalized a major tax credit for clean hydrogen and previously awarded some $7 billion to jumpstart clean hydrogen at seven hydrogen hubs connected to companies like Amazon and ExxonMobil. Trump, however, has called Biden climate policies a green new scam.
The Trump administration has said that energy independence is very important for them. So I don't think there will be a reduction in the level of support.
In Texas, ECL is building a data center that's 1,000 times bigger than its pilot site in California. The 1-gigawatt project is near some 600 miles of hydrogen pipelines, so it won't need to be trucked in and stored. ECL plans to complete the $8 billion project in 2029 and run it entirely on green hydrogen, eventually.
We're defining a new type of hydrogen called turquoise, which is a mix of blue and green, until we'll be able to get to 100% green, which is probably going to take between 4 and 5 years.
For now, with blue hydrogen, Bahar says ECL's gotten the price down to 6 cents per kilowatt hour, about a third the average price of power in the U.S. He says ECL has 4 customers committed at the Texas site so far and is in talks with 16 more.
It's the Microsoft, Facebooks, Amazons, and Googles of the world, which require all of this technology to be placed somewhere. And right now, somewhere is nowhere because there's no more availability of data center space in the United States.
But so far, much of the hype and spend has focused on nuclear.
So this is our nuclear reactor model, a prototype that we've staged here in Washington, D.C. at full scale.
Washington, D.C.-based Last Energy is one of many companies that have gone all in on small modular reactors, or SMRs.
This is everything that you need to have a nuclear battery create 80 megawatts of heat and eventually 20 megawatts of electricity.
The idea is to bring reactors to the data centers. No need to build in proximity of a big nuclear plant.
Traditional nuclear power hit a bit of a period of stagnation several decades ago. Between the rising construction costs and the lengthy timelines to deliver the product, it proved unfeasible.
So Amazon, Google, and Microsoft are all investing in SMRs. Meta is seeking developers to help it add up to 4 gigawatts of nuclear generation capacity by the early 2030s, and Last Energy submitted a proposal. In fact, half of Last Energy's 80 commercial agreements for 20 megawatt units are going to AI data centers.
And then the other half are going to more traditional industrial applications. This includes pulp and paper, cement, sugar processing, steel tube manufacturing.
Last Energy's first 4 SMRs are scheduled to come online in 2027, powering data centers on a former coal plant site in Wales. But with AI demands already here, some traditional plants are getting another life. Microsoft is restarting a mothballed nuclear plant on Three Mile Island in Pennsylvania that's been shut down since 2019 and was the scene of the worst commercial nuclear accident in U.S. history in 1979. Radiation has always been a threat, whether it's from a potential leak during an accident or safely disposing of the resulting radioactive waste.
Our solution, by fully encompassing all radioactive material and systems in a 12-inch steel containment structure, allows us to mitigate the waste issue by fundamentally isolating it.
That's relatively low risk, but you've got to build a safety record around it. And they're relatively small reactors. You need a lot of those to power one of these big AI data centers.
That's why startup Helion is trying to create a lot more nuclear power in an entirely new way. Instead of shrinking down existing nuclear reactors, Helion is trying to harness energy from a very different type of reaction. Fusion, the combining of two atoms.
Fusion is the way the sun works. Only here on Earth, we've actually struggled to be able to do it in a commercializable, cost-effective way. We've built now a number of machines showing that we can do that.
Microsoft has signed on to buy fusion power from Helion for one of its data centers in Washington State in 2028. It's an ambitious goal, considering scientists have been trying for decades to sustain fusion reactions long enough to harness energy from them.
Nuclear options are probably 5 years out. Even if they say, yeah, maybe 2029, it's probably going to be delayed. No one's actually made fusion work, really, yet.
Helion's seventh prototype, Polaris, came online in December. Kirtley says it will be the first to make a fusion reaction that generates electricity, something China's also been racing to achieve. In 2021, Altman invested $375 million in Helion, and he's the company's board chair.
The goal is to actually site fusion power at the data center, or at least pretty close to it.
Helion's goal isn't just to make fusion work, but work as cheaply as possible.
Obviously, fusion in the universe scales really well. So we've been aiming to get to a fusion system that is on the order of a few cents per kilowatt hour.
Affordable nuclear power is also Jacob DeWitt's goal, but with fission.
When I learned that you could take basically a golf ball of uranium metal and there's enough energy content in that to power my entire life's energy needs, I was like, this seems like it's from something in science fiction, but oh wait, we're actually doing it now.
Fission creates energy by splitting atoms apart instead of fusing them together.
It's probably the least risky from a technology point of view, and probably the earliest one that we'll see actually up and running.
Oklo has plans for thousands of plug-and-play fission reactors housed below sleek A-frame powerhouses.
I mean, nuclear is just such an elegant way to make power, and we need to basically unleash that.
Oklo expects its first microreactor to come online in 2027 at the Idaho National Laboratory. DeWitt thinks federal support will continue.
Those things were actually granted to us under Trump 1, so there's kind of an interesting arc that kind of goes forward here.
Sam Altman chairs Oklo's board in addition to Helion's. Oklo went public in May 2024 and has been trending up so far in 2025 after signing a deal with data center operator Switch to deploy 12 gigawatts of power to a fleet of small nuclear reactors through 2044, enough electricity to power some 9 million U.S. households. Some decades-old technologies are also seeing renewed interest. Geothermal, for example. Google has partnered with Fervo Energy to help power its data centers in Nevada with electricity made from heat deep within the Earth's core.
The first geothermal power plant came online over 100 years ago in Italy. But historically, unless you've had places where there's volcanic activity and where steam is literally coming out of the ground, like parts of Italy or Iceland or New Zealand, it hasn't been viable to develop geothermal. And so as a result, geothermal today is less than 1% of the world's electricity. It's less than 1% of the electricity in the United States.
At its full-scale pilot project in Nevada, Fervo drills 8,000-foot deep wells.
But then we were able to turn and drill 3,000 feet horizontally so that every well we drill is getting access to much more geothermal reservoir than a vertical well would.
The deep wells get filled with water heated by the Earth's core. Steam is pumped back to the surface where it powers a turbine that generates electricity. Fervo's first 3-megawatt site in Nevada has been producing power since 2023. Fervo is also working with Google on a new, bigger 115-megawatt site set to come online by 2030 in Nevada. In Utah, a $2 billion project is slated to deliver geothermal power to the grid next year, with plans to scale to 400 megawatts by 2028.
Enough to power nearly 500,000 homes.
Then there's solar, a plentiful green energy source, but tricky to capture consistently for 24/7 needs.
And so the way to solve that is to try to combine solar panels with batteries.
Altman invested $20 million in Exowatt last year.
We've invented this special lens that captures the solar energy and converts it to high temperature heat. And so this allows us to store the heat in these heat batteries or thermal batteries very cost effectively, especially as compared to electricity. All of this is packaged in a modular system that is roughly the size of a 40-foot shipping container.
Happy says 1,100 of Exowatt's 25 kilowatt hour modules will be deployed this year. That's a fraction of what's needed to power a data center, but the idea is to sell multiple modules to meet the precise energy demands of each site. The modules currently sell for $7,500 and make electricity at about 4 cents per kilowatt hour. The goal is to sell a couple million in the next 2 years, and with scale, to bring that cost down to just 1 cent per kilowatt hour.
Energy at the end of the day is a commodity. People really don't care how you produce your energy, they just care how expensive it is.
As the world gains a better grasp on the efficiency of China's DeepSeek, time will tell if power demand continues at breakneck speed. But at least for now, alternative energies are benefiting from the deep pockets of AI.
What's the right way to fix global warming and decarbonization? It's like all of the things. You want to bias your investments towards the things that are lowest cost now, but you have to invest in what's going to come. Otherwise, it won't arrive, right?